It's amazing. I have been here for the last 30 years in that audience among you. I never thought I'll be here in a different state or in a different scenario. Thank you, Dr. Suleiman, for introduction. But I just want to add to that the true story of what he told. That after he was told that I have deleted all the names of all the girls from your heart, he said, no, I can write many more then. He said, all the clean slate. He also had a sense of humor, much, much more than at that, even after the bypass operation it was done. I was told to talk about heart transplants. Probably many of you want to know how it happened and how it was going through. I was dreaming about it for several years. And my friends, my colleagues, they used to tell me that it's going not to be happen here. Don't even try, you are wasting your time. They used to laugh at me, joke at me. For a year or 2 years, I did not go anywhere for any meeting, any conference, in a hope that I'll get one patient. And when I had a patient, I didn't go out because I was hoping for a donor. And then it realized that it is like a, when the recipient is in your hospital and you look at him and he cannot breathe, gasping, and you can't do anything else. I'll come to that, but it is very frustrating. The accomplishments today in the science are happening in such a dazzling speed, and here you are standing in front of death, cannot do anything. And one thing I knew, that we can do a transplant for such patients. I met Dr. Nitu Wanke for the first time in my life and the last time in my life in Boston in 2003. When I was that time in Gujarat, in Surat, in setting up a center there for Mahavirat Hospital. And he said, you leave Gujarat and come here. And for 3 days he accompanied me, said that I'm not leaving you. So I used to go to these transplant sessions. And he used to follow me and sit with me there, just convincing me to come back. 15 days after he died, after we came from Boston, 15 days after he died, I never worked with him. But I thought, that time if the transplant program was in Mumbai, he would have been alive today with us. And so I dedicated my first heart transplant to Dr. Nitu Wanke. When I was going through this journey and nothing was happening, and as I told you, that when the patient in your hospital in intensive care unit who is on a deathbed, and we know I cannot do, there is no other fifth medicine that I can give it to him to keep him alive, and I was not getting the donors, and I lost a couple of patients like that, it was like when a dog comes to you, on you, when you're walking on the road, you try to find a stone and you will never see a stone. And when you carry a stone in your pocket, you will never see a dog coming on you. So in transplant is something like donor and recipient is something is like that, what is happening or what was happening. The scenes are changing now slowly, but you have to be really patient. And when I was going through these dreams and rehearsal of myself, and I realized that it is not passion of only one person, and you need a team in whom from their own inside should come that voice, no, we want to do this transplant. We don't want to see such patients dying anymore if we can help them. And that time I realized that it was like tying a knot without a thread in your hand. But In surgery, the predictions are very unpredictable. And that is what I was banking on. And like a Macbeth, who asked the witches, that if you look into the seeds of time and throw them and ask which grain will grow and which will not, and then speak to me. And that is what exactly has resulted. You just keep trying and trying and keep throwing the seeds, and it will work one day. Your parents, your teachers are all anxious that you be a good student and good accommodation and good doctor. But they're also anxious that you be a good human being. And that culture or that part or character building, I would say, is most important part. You can become a student or accreditation online also, sitting at home. But it's your friends, the organization of such beautiful trinity, symposiums, meeting different people from the different part of the world, understanding, arguing, loving, that makes your character. And that is what is very essential in digging out such things out of nowhere. The Mumbai was on the front of the medical scenario in the country at one time. And for some reasons, some mysterious reasons, it has fallen back. And it is slowly coming up. And I think that every one of you has a chance to become European. Now, everybody is doing cardiac surgery and everybody is in the bypass surgery and valve surgery and bypass surgery. But you look at it differently in the same things. And there are so many things you can do. And amazingly, you will realize that there is no branch or no field or no fraternity of our medical faculty that, you know, will not give you chance of becoming hero like this. It's only, again, I'm telling you, it's only the character building. And apart from my friends, my batchmates, my seniors, juniors, and teachers, one of the teachers, probably not many of you will know them, him, is Dr. Anil Tendulkar. I was his first student as a cardiac surgeon, who was a professor of cardiac surgery and head of the department here in San Hospital. He retired now, he's not there anymore. He's there, but he's not in academic or in academic hospital there. Madam, I am Anil Tendulkar. I didn't see you, madam. So he is the one who has made what I am today as a cardiac surgeon. More and more above as an academician or as a student, it's a personality development and thinking of that kind which has made me today what I am today. I will not take much of your time.
I have the slides. So.
And I know why I'm here today. And this is what everybody knows, and this is what everybody is told. And there are certain operations, and there are certain more complex operations, which I'm proud of myself of doing them, and I'm known in a cardiac surgery for that. But I became more famous to a man as a man on the street also because of this heart transplant. At the time of happening it, I was not sure that I didn't know all this will happen, and I was the first time successful and decent successful, and I was not remembering also that 47 years back this was tried and this has failed and whatever it is. The story behind this success I told you, and it is a dream which was all the time I was harboring, and it has come true. It is not only dream of one person. But it's a teamwork, and without the team, it is impossible. The biggest hero, and honestly, I'm sincerely saying this again, and this is one of the take-home message I want each one of you to take home. The biggest hero, the real hero, the honest hero of this cardiac surgery transplant program is the donors' families. We have awarded them in a subtle ways. The government, we are pursuing the governments to do it in a subtle ways. But after all, it's a donation. And we cannot repay it or give a finance. Otherwise, that word donation has to be taken out. I'll come to that in a later half of this story. But the second team, second group who should be honored is the team who relentlessly work day and night for this program. And once we know that there is a donor on horizon also, we leave everything. We leave everything, what is in our hand and mind, and then start working on it. Sometimes it fails, sometimes it works. So far it has worked 10 times, and today night we are going for another transplant. Why night is because 11:30 is auspicious time for the family, is India. So it's auspicious time for a family, and they are not willing to give the organs, or they are not willing to declare him dead before 11:30 tonight. This thing is happening since yesterday. And if it had happened yesterday, probably I would not have been able to attend this meeting today. So you must also thank to this donor's family that I could come here. But there are very, very, very interesting stories I can tell you and keep telling you the whole night it will go on, that has emerged from these last 10, 11 transplants, amazingly. But it is in it is India, and we have to get a logistics of transplant and logistics of working around the culture, the traditions of the society. We do not have Obama healthcare package here, and we have to make Modi's make in India, and we have to train ourselves that I cannot say that, oh, I was in abroad and I did 800 and I did 500, it is like this, and why it is not like this, it's useless, it's totally useless. And we have to see in a total different perspective to at the same problem or the same situation that we have come and arrived to this situation. For example, the first time I did the first transplant, I'll tell you in very shortly, that it was Saturday and I was Friday night, and I had two patients who were following up for like 3, 4, 5 months, and they were daily coming for some injection, Lasix and this and that, and I was requesting them to get admitted, but they refused to get admitted. And then one fine day, they decided to, one fine day, I told them that you must get admitted, otherwise you will collapse anytime. They refused. At night they called me, at 3 o'clock one fellow, and on 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock another patient, they called me, I sent the ambulance, got them to the hospital, stabilized them, and I had to go to the Pune because my wife had a dengue and her platelet count was 13,000. So I stabilized them and went to Pune, that was Saturday morning. I took her to the hospital, admitted her for platelet transfusion because she was bleeding, petechial hemorrhages and everything. And then I realized that her platelet count was slowly growing up, but there was a potential donor at Jahangir Hospital. It is unethical to go to this hospital and talk to the relatives before they declare the donation of the organs or before their apnea test is done, because it's a conflict of interest. So through my social coordinator, I asked them, but there was no news at all. In the evening, my platelets count went up, and then without giving a transfusion, so I decided to, on the Sunday morning, decided to bring her home. And Sunday evening, I started living back to Mumbai as usual. In the evening, there was a landslide. And the traffic jam, I was there holed up for 2 hours in the traffic jam in Khandala Ghat. There was nothing but my cell phone with me. So I picked up the cell phone, called the coordinator, social coordinator in our hospital. Do you know anybody in Jahangir Hospital who can tell us about what is happening about this donor? And he said that at 6:30 we are getting doing the first apnea test. I said, fantastic. The 6:30 I got a phone call, the first apnea test is positive. What is the apnea test? I'll let you know. And then the second apnea test is after 6 hours. So I sent the first alert on a WhatsApp. We have made a group there of the heart transplant and called everybody that be on a group of what is happening. And then slowly the process started, and whole night around 11:30 I sent the team of doctors to with the blood grouping cross matching to Mumbai to Pune, and then they decided for which one patient to do this or that. There was a lot of argument going on among ourselves in a discussion. And then when I came home around 11:30, I thought that I took 5 hours to come from Pune to Mumbai. If I get this transplant heart, then 5 hours is gone, because heart transplant, unlike liver or kidney, is a race against time. You have to do everything in 4 hours. Whatever the cardioplegia or the preservatives we give to the patient, to the heart of the donor's heart, once we stop the blood circulation of it and restart the blood circulation on the recipient, it gives me 4 hours. Whatever, transport, everything, my suturing, taking the organ out and fixing it, everything is within 4 hours. And if I take 5 hours in only transport, so road is not an option for me. And it was 12 o'clock when I went home, midnight, and then I called my friend Brigadier Garg from Army in CTC Pune. He's a cardiac surgeon, head of the department there. And he said, Anvay, I cannot help you. We have got an Air Force here. And the Air Force does not have a small helicopters or airplanes. They have got a fighter planes, which will take the organ from Pune to Mumbai in 7 minutes. But the civilians are not allowed, and you have to take the permission from New Delhi Ministry, Defense Ministry, from your headquarters of 40s from Delhi. I said, it is impossible. So I was thinking what to do. And then I remembered my friend Deshmukh, Captain Deshmukh, in Ashwini Hospital, Navy. He is a cardiac surgeon. He sometimes comes to see us operating. So I called him and he said, Anvay, I cannot help you, but I know somebody. He is a general surgeon, Captain Samir Kapoor. And you call him and he is a coordinator for this Navy helicopters. So I called him around 1:45. He didn't pick up the phone. 1 o'clock, he didn't pick the phone. 1:15, he didn't pick up the phone. I called Deshmukh back. I said, he's a coordinator, but he is not answering the phone. So he gave me a landline number. I called him a landline. His wife picked up the phone and said, what is the problem? So I was explaining to her, and then he came on the phone and said, I'm not well. So, but he said, I can help you out, but no civilians are allowed on a helicopter. I said, I can't give heart to your pilot and disappear. So there has to be somebody who will be accompanying you on your helicopter. He said, I have to take the permission. I said, no problem. By around 2:15, he called me back and said, one doctor is allowed. I was so happy. So where you want? I said, Pune. What time you want? 11:30 in the morning. I said, done. I was about to sleep and then thought, August, monsoon, black clouds. The helicopter is good enough for Navy to go on a seashores and on a ocean. But here the mountains, black clouds, visibility. There is, if the helicopters are not see through the clouds, they don't have the facilities to see through the clouds, which the air bus always has, the aircraft always has, or GPS always they have, then I'll be stuck. Because of the weather, they say, no, we can't fly. I'm gone, finished. So I called at 3 o'clock, I called private chartered planes. So he said, who is going? The chartered plane said that it will cost you this much and it will from Pune. Give us 2 hours notice. He said, who is going to pay? I said, I'll pay. And that time I thought that for learning, you have to pay. And that was the money I put in my education. My daughter is in final MBBS and she finished final MBBS and she was doing third internship. And when she was in rural posting, one evening she called me and said that there is one mother has got some baby who is 11 months or something old and she's dehydrated, loose motions, diarrhea, vomiting. She requires some IV fluid, so I wrote down on a paper and gave it to the sister and told him to arrange. So after finishing the OPD, I thought I'll put IV line and at least I'll also get to learn, sir. But then realized that patient is not there, patient not admitted. So she was going out for a lunch or a dinner or something. And then she realized that that same mother was sitting on the roadside crying with the baby in her hand. Said, what happened? She said, I don't have money. Sister told me to buy all these things, but I don't have money. So she said, why the government doesn't pay? I said, forget about what government should do and should not do. You want to learn? Put down your phone, put your hand in your pocket, give her a money, tell her to buy. And if you can't put that IV line in that 11-month dehydrated child, put in a car and take it to the nearest center. You want to learn? Pay the money. But that is what today's scenario is. And if you want really to go ahead, just don't hesitate. I would say, don't hesitate to help the poor, to reach to the unreachables, for your learning or for your education. I won't take much of your time. The another people I want to thank is for Mumbai Police, Police Commissioners of Madhya Pradesh Indore, Police Commissioner of Surat, Police Commissioner of Mumbai and Thane. And they really, really helped us. As I told you, it's a race against time, and the green corridor and the help from airport to the air authorities to getting the plane and everything, and from the organ from 17 minutes or 16 minutes from Santa Cruz airport to the Fortis Mulund, which was amazing. It is fantastic. We know the power of the police. They can do it if they really want to do it, and they are so happy to do it than to just help day and night for the politicians for this noble cause of the organ. They are extremely happy, and they did it very, very happily. This is a team. This doesn't include all of them, but there are some missing there. But I apologize for that. But whatever I can show, I had the photographs, I'll come to them. I'll come to today's topic. The heart failure, as you all of you know, is a left heart failure, right heart failure, and a congestive heart cardiac failure. I'm going to simplify it and tell you. It's a clinical syndrome characterized by low output of the left ventricle. That is why low perfusion, decreased perfusion. And the right ventricle, it fails, it causes congestion in the back organs like lung, liver, and kidney. There are, some of them are compensated, some of them are decompensated. Nature has its way, neurohormonal ways, to compensate the failure and help the body to recover until to a last second, last minute. It is a phenomenal system the God has given us in our body. And the compensated, when it becomes decompensated, they come to us. This is a take-home chart I want you to concentrate on. And if you look at this, this is a gradual graph you see from normal to refractory congestive heart failure. And when you see this normal, asymptomatic, compensated, decompensated, it doesn't go all the time in that way. It is a book picture. It is what the graph should classically be. But you will see the patients who are compensated suddenly become refractory. And that is the nature's, you can't defy, and you can't help out on that. My first patient was like in 8 years back, patient had a post-pregnancy heart failure. For 8 years, she was fine, working at home, doing everyday duties, no problem, nothing. She was following with the doctor. Nobody has told her about the heart transplant because of the congestive cardiac failure. She had the dilated cardiomyopathy after the pregnancy. But then when she came to me, she was refractory. In few months, and in few weeks, she became from decompensated to refractory. That was so fast, I could see. But when I told that time that we have to have a heart transplant and get registered, they refused. Because for last 8 years, nobody has told. And in 2 weeks, this man is telling me to get a heart transplanted done. It is not easy to digest in Indian scenario. However, at the end, when they decided to go for a transplant, then she became so bad, I had to put on a ventilator, put an intra-aortic balloon pump, put inotropes and everything, weaned her off once, tried again, but I was not getting a donor. No donor on horizon. And then comes a mechanical assist device, and I asked for a mechanical assist device from Delhi. It was coming on Monday morning, and Sunday was the one day which I will never ever forget in my life, that she decompensated so fast and she had arrhythmias so fast that in spite of putting the ICD and defibrillator, the outside, from outside, we keep giving the shocks. That night I must have given almost 150 shocks to her, but could not keep her alive until morning, until we get a mechanical assist device, left ventricle device. But this is what it is, and nobody understands that, okay, I am fine, asymptomatic and compensated, but nobody on earth. And then there is one chart which I will give you, which will tell us that it will come. So my point here is that though it is a gradual process and gradual thing which should happen, it not every patient or every case this happens. To myself, to try to remember the symptoms, to make it very FACES, F-A-C-E-S-S, if the fatigue activity decreases, cough, edema and shortness of breath. All of you know the stages of the heart failure, which is given in your pathology books. The stage A, B, C, D. First is a high risk patients, like we have to find the risk factors. They become structural damage, and then become a functional damage and become symptomatic. And then fourth, D is a refractory period. And NYHA classification of class 1, 2, 3, 4, all of you know, when you have become in a third MBBS and clinical duties will start is the classification is very well known. So when these patients in class 4, class 3, they can't breathe, they can't walk, they are gasping even on the bed, and then they come to us, and then we find out which is a cause, or etiology of it, is going to be reversible or not. Because there was one patient I remember, post-pregnancy heart failure, but she didn't wait for 8 years. She, in 8 days, that patient deteriorated so fast in New Delhi, Fortis Hospital, New Delhi, our group only. And then we decided to move her to Chennai, because Chennai, in South India, we get more donors than here. It's amazing. In this study, what I did for this transplants, one of the study I did for donors, one two interesting things I will tell you just now at this stage is the donors in Mumbai, the maximum donors we get in August. I don't know if it's Ganpati related, because Ganpati was the first transplant, hair transplant. But in Kerala, the number of donors are amazingly, if I get one donor in 1 month or 2 months, in Kerala they get in 1 week or 10 days one donor. In as you go from south to north, very interestingly, the attitude of donating the organ goes down drastically, dramatically. Almost as you go to Haryana, up there it is almost zero. Don't know why, but amazing. And when I was discussing with my friends in army, they also told the same thing, the jawans and all, the as you go from south to north, there are the donation rate of the organs I'm talking about, it goes down drastically. So we decided to from Delhi to shift a patient to Chennai and for organ transplant, for heart transplant. And she was an intra-aortic balloon pump, she couldn't cope. We put her on an aeroplane, and at altitude of that level, the intra-aortic balloon pump, many of you may not be knowing it, it works on a helium gas. And the helium gas is a light gas, and that gas doesn't work at that altitude. So intra-aortic balloon pump stopped working. So we had to, she crashed. So we had to get her down again on a land. And then we move her from left intra-aortic balloon pump to the ECMO. From ECMO, we put her on ECMO. That time she arrested, massaged her, resuscitated her. Put her on ECMO, transferred to the Chennai. For 2 days she was okay, but started deteriorating again arrested. And then again, for some reason, her blood group donor was not, they were not getting donor for another, nothing on the horizon. So because she was deteriorating very fast, arresting again and again, they decided to put her on mechanical assist device or artificial heart or a left ventricle assist device, LVAD. It cost almost 1 crore. And the family was good, and they decided to put her on her. She's fine. She's moving around the world, traveling almost 20,000 miles in 6 months from here to USA to across the globe and world. And she visited the Mayo Clinic, and when we put the left ventricle assist device, we have to make the hole in the left ventricle, and that muscle, they send it for the biopsy to the Mayo Clinic, and amazingly, she has become a polysaccharide glycogen disorder, which is genetically treated. So she is waiting for now getting genetic treatment at Mayo Clinic. Once the genetic treatment is done, they expect her heart function to come back to normal. So take the LVAD out, she has her own heart. The transplant is not done. So there are some few viruses, few medical conditions, which are reversible even in the heart transplant. But at certain time of their dilatation of the ventricle, if the dimensions of the left ventricle goes beyond that level, then it is important that the remodeling of this ventricle does not happen. And this is one of the most important slide to take home as a student also, or when you become a clinician, as any kind of a doctor you become. And these 3 letters of this left ventricle is more than 4 cm². So if your left ventricular internal diameter is more than 4 cm² of your body surface area, and if I look as Indians, then 1.6 or 1.7 is our body surface area. Take it for practical purpose as 1.5. That means 4 is 1, and then 0.5 means 2. So 4 plus 2, 6. If the internal diameter on echocardiography is more than 6 cm of any Indian, then the chances that he is a dilated cardiomyopathy patient, they will not become, remodeling of this ventricle does not happen. Remember, whatever the etiology, But what you see, what we always see on echocardiography report is an ejection fraction. Let the ejection fraction be 10%, 15%, 5%, 30%. If your left ventricular dimensions are more than 6 centimeters for an Indian scenario, then the chance that this ventricle will not remodel and the chance this patient do not survive for more than 2 years. Remember, 50% of them die within 2 years. It's amazing. And that is what is most important is. Irrespective of the etiology, irrespective of the ejection fraction, this holds the true. This is a busy slide from the Harrison, and I was trying to simplify it. And here we see that there is stage 1, stage A and B here. The stage A and B here is a high risk factors. All of you know the hypertension, coronary artery disease, diabetes, dilated cardiomyopathies, congenital heart diseases, which are cannot be corrected at all. They all land up into the heart failure at one stage of life. They become structural heart defects, and the structural heart damages can give progress to the dilatation of the ventricle, and then they become symptomatic from this. And the treatment for this is the control of the hypertension, smoking, diet, and fluid restrictions, and exercise, and all these things are there. And then is a stage B, is the same thing. And then here you see when they become the stage C, the shortness of breath and known structural heart diseases patients, you have the treatment, and you will see these 4 medicines that works with. You have got digoxin, you have got diuretics, AC inhibitors and beta blockers. I do not know the 5th medicine. And the patients go from one doctor to another doctor. For a few days they feel good. The other doctor increase the dose or change the brand. Again for a few days they feel good. Again they find the 3rd doctor. I was feeling better, but no more. I am not feeling good at all. The patient and doctor also get frustrated. They know there is nothing I can do about it. And the patient keeps moving here from there from there and everything. And they come to these big centers. I give one injection Lasix or something. And they again feel better. They just want to go home with that injection. And again they get addicted. And then I have to put them on patients on inotropes after a few days. They become frequent flyers. They keep coming, going, and this continues. And that is what, I do not have the 5th medicine to help them to come out of this heart failure. There is no medicine which will improve the pumping of the heart. All these medicines what we are giving is to decrease the congestion of the kidney and the liver and the lungs, so they remain in a good condition. There is nothing wrong with these organs. Just because the heart is failing, causing a back pressure, they also become bad. And if they become into multi-organ failure, then heart transplant does not work. So what we have to do is that keep these other organs in a good condition until they get donor heart for the transplant. And when they become a refractory, these are the only thing, the stage A and C, the mechanical assist device and heart transplantation is the only means of treatment. Apart from this, in surgery, we have tried everything. They have tried transmyocardial reverse by lasers. They have tried into mitral clip repair, the cardiomyoplasties, then decor procedures, and whatnot. They have tried everything until they have realized that nothing has been worked so far, and the stem cell therapy is still in a research stage. It has not helped in clinical scenarios at all. And only the last 2 things you can see here, the mechanical circulatory support and heart transplant, are the only 2 things which has been remembered. So which are the patients who require heart transplants? Any kind of heart failure, severe heart failure, it may be valvular, it may be ischemic, it may be congenital, it may be dilated cardiomyopathy, it may be viral myocarditis, it may be post-pregnancy, or whatever the reason is, severe heart failure is the indication for heart transplant, irrespective of the etiology. A patient who has got debilitating refractory angina, you have tried aggressive medical treatment, done angioplasties, done surgeries, bypass operation, second bypass operation, third bypass operation. There is nothing we can do about graftable things, or nothing we can do the angioplastable things, but patient is still an angina. He is not in failure. He is not in failure, but refractory angina, not responding to any medical or surgical treatment, these are the candidates for the heart transplant. Sorry. And the 3rd group is the one who has got intractable arrhythmias, irrespective of the ICDs, because of the dilatation of the heart, dilatation of the ventricle, the fibrosis which is happening in this ventricle causes intractable arrhythmias, and these are the candidates for. So the patients are waiting for the heart transplantation, who are refractory to all means of medical support are the candidates and should be considered for a mechanical assist device until they get transplanted. And that is called bridge to the transplant. But the cost of it, this is so much that in India, I call it a destination therapy. Even abroad, now it will become a destination therapy. I will explain to you how it has become. So the mechanical assist devices are of two types. One is for bridge to the transplant and one is for destination therapy. The bridge to the transplant is called ECMO or the intra-aortic balloon pumps or left ventricle assist device. But this left ventricle assist device are quite huge and quite big. And then they only give me 4 to 5 weeks to play with. This is important slide. I've got an NYHA classification. You have got a heart failure classification. I'll go through this slide, which is easy to read. And you go from below upward. So if you are in level 6 of heart failure, it is very good. Your level 1 is very bad. Remember. So the level 1, they are walking wounded. They know they have a problem. They come to the hospital, they get some medicine, they go home, they are happy, they walk around, but very, very slowly. They can't run, they cannot do any over-exercise activity. But they give me months if nutrition and everything is maintained. Remember, months. Months. So maybe 11, 12 months or said, if we can calculate in the months, after that they deteriorate so fast that they will not be there. Then they become housebound. After that they cannot go out of the house. They become breathless, irrespective of whatever the medicines you give or whatever treatment you give. And they give few weeks or months. And they start coming to the hospital for injection. And now they started giving injection Mildrinon. That patient can go home with the injection Mildrinon. They are very happy. One thing I realize about these patients of the heart failure, since I am following them up, is that they don't want to get admitted. They know what difficulties for each breath. Each breath, the difficulty they have. And every breath, when they get difficulty, they don't want to leave their relatives. They don't want to leave their family. They don't want to leave their house. They hate hospital. They don't want to get admitted. So they are happy if I give them Mildrinon. And then infusion pumps which are coming now, they can send them home with that Mildrinon infusion, be at home. And they become so addicted. I get my phone calls at 3 o'clock or 2 o'clock midnight asking me that I am finished Mildrinon and I am getting breathless. So please send somebody and refill it. So that is what they become dependent on it. And then they become frequent flyers, coming and going to the hospital, take injection Lasix, they feel better, go home. And they become, after that also, they have to get admitted, put them on inotrope. They are stable, but dependent on inotropes. I cannot bring them out of the ICU. And then they start to become sliding fast, which gives me days to weeks. If I don't do anything in between these few days or few weeks, they die. And then they crash and burn. So this is the last stage, crash and burn. Then this is even a few hours if I want to put in the mechanical assist device or something like that. So this is what we Intermax scoring system that we discuss what level your patient is. Level 6, level 5, level, don't worry. You know, give me some months. Let me arrange. Let me find out for the transplant. But if I have got a patient in level 2, then I put them on national alert or high priority. Means I tell my ZTC that the patient is registered for transplant. I am not getting a donor in Mumbai or in Maharashtra. Put them on national list. So if anybody anywhere from India, I am getting a donor like Indore or Surat or nearby state, then they are divided into the zones, east zone, west zone, north and south zone. So if I got in that my zone, I will get a priority. If not, it goes in the nationwide radar. That patient will go on nationwide radar. So that is what classification it means. So these are the left ventricular assist devices which look very bulky, but they are external. They are like by the side of me and in the bed. I cannot leave the ICU with them. I am still in ICU. I can walk around, move around, eat and drink, but I am stuck to the bed and stuck to the these machines. They give me 4 to 5 weeks to find me a donor. So these are temporary ones. They are left ventricular assist. They are temporary ones. They don't cost. They will cost around almost 10 lakhs or something like that at this stage in India. But then the same machine, what you are seeing here, this big one, the same machine is now, by technology, they have made it into the size of your thumb. Amazing. And that we can implant it. And so one tube goes into the left ventricle, other tube goes into the aorta. That's all. That's all. The rest of the thing is done by this machine. And then there is a battery charger, like your cell phone. Nowadays you find a bed where there is a charger for your cell phone, isn't it? You don't find a window or something that you can see the stars. You find a charger. Similarly, these patients have to find a charger at night. You put on a wall to this charger and you get charged. Whole day you can walk around, travel around. The NASA is trying to find out now the percutaneous charging of these batteries. So there won't be any cable coming out of your body. So that is what they're doing it. But this is amazingly a small one. And these are percutaneous drive lens. They are electrically powered. And the fixed speed operating mode, there is a small computer which controls the rate and the speed of this blood flow. These patients amazingly remember that any patient who has an LVAD or mechanical assist device will not have pulse, because it's a continuous flow. And it is so happened when we put the patient that I told you from Delhi to Chennai, and when we put an ECMO and brought it back, the medical officer in Delhi said that there is no pulse felt. How can you transfer the patient like that if there is no pulse felt? So we had to explain to him that ECMO, in ECMO machine or in the left medical assist device, there won't be pulse felt. Absolutely no pulse. You cannot take the blood pressure. It is displayed on the computer here. On a, what is the blood pressure and all, it is displayed, everything is there, because it's a continuous flow, it's not a pulsatile flow. So these devices are now getting more, and that is how you can look here with the LVAD. So from bridge to the transplant, it has become a destination therapy. That there are some patients who doesn't want to go to the transplant now. They are happy with this. Like a valve replacement, you take one warfarin tablet every day and enjoy your life. No limitation activities in these patients. So for refractory heart failure, mechanical assist device and heart transplant are the key. Which are the patients who will not do transplant? Any patient who had, so we do the right heart catheter or catheter studies in this patient, of the heart patients, to find out whether he needs only heart, or heart and lung, or only lung is bad, or both are bad. That we have to find out by doing the pulmonary vascular resistance and other things. But any patient who had irreversible pulmonary heart damage, irreversible renal hepatic dysfunction, multi-organ failure, diabetes which is causing, you know, multi-organ end-stage damages, elderly patient more than 70 or the malignancies, we are not candidate for the transplant. They are not candidates for the transplants. I was doing this study that why should we do this transplant? Just how many are done in USA and what happens to these patients? Am I going to merely keep this patient alive and nothing else? Is that the reason why I'm doing a transplant? And I realized that the transplant, you can see the green line, that is what the transplant done in USA, and this is only till 2009, but it has not much changed in 2011 or 2013. The number of the transplant done in USA are for last many, many years is up to 2,500 per year. They have not grown. The yellow is what you see is Europe, and the red is the rest of the world. And this yellow is also slowly coming down, if you realize. Why the number of transplants are coming down? Why they are not going up in USA? And the reason is that the donors are getting less and less. Donors of the in USA and Europe are remaining same, 2,500 per year. But the number of recipients requiring transplant is going up and up exponentially, very high. So that is why the mechanical assist device and artificial heart is helping those patients who cannot get a donor or who are waiting on a very long, long list of the donors. Then that is what the graph is looking like. So those patients who get this transplant, what is their functional status? And amazingly, red is what is no activity limitations. Can you believe it? There is no activity limitation. You are in NYHA class 1. From NYHA class 4, you are in NYHA class 1 at the end of the 5 years in almost more than 90% of the patients. Amazing. And it has nothing to do with my transplant technique has changed or surgical technique has changed. It has to do with the immunosuppressions have changed. And that has helped tremendously. The awareness of the immunosuppression, the understanding of the immunosuppression, knowledge about the immunosuppression, which one will suit, what are the side effects, how the rejection is handled, all these things has helped to increase the NYHA classification of these patients. And most of these patients are back to employ, back to their job or back to the work. Almost 80% of the patients are going back to the work. All the 10 patients where we are considering, we are talking about in Mumbai we are done, out of 10, the 4 are back to the work. The 1 is household, she's again back to the work, so 5th one. And the 6, 7, 1 are just coming out of 1 month or 2 month old. So they will be slowly going back to the work. One is from Indian Oil, one is from software company and other things. So if you look at the rehospitalization rate, those patients who are frequent flyers, those patients are stable and dependent on ICUs. Now, at the end of the 5 years, if you see, 80% of the patients, they do not come to the hospital at all for heart problem. They do not come.
And that is beauty of it. So they don't have to come again and again to the hospital just because the transplant is done. There are certain tests which has to be done. For that they come once in 3 months or once in a month. One of the tests is a biopsy, myocardial biopsy, and that is what it is. So the heart transplant remains the ultimate treatment for the heart failure patients. So we started the heart failure clinics, and I don't want to go into the detail of it, but the problems with the management issues of the heart failure, why the people are not interested, why the doctors are not interested, for unfortunately, and the high mortality, high readmission rate, same patient, not adherent to treatment, patient will say that, oh, I'm taking this medicine, nothing is helping me, why should I take this medicine? They go from Ayurvedic to allopathy to homeopathy and everywhere, and they keep moving around that. They reduce quality of life. There is no zero or any ambitions in the life left because they can't do anything. They can't breathe for themselves. And that is what is the. So we try to close this adherence gap in this patient by taking the Mildenone to the household. And now the patients with the Mildenone now can be followed by the physicians or by the GPs. And remaining adhering to these strategies, we have developed a beautiful network which is helping us to monitor these patients at home and not to visit us again and again at our different levels. So we need to stop condemning our stage D heart failure patients and conquer the last frontier about it. Can I have the next presentation, please? This is about your heart failure and this is academic talk. But my real aim or the real talk is I want each one of you to be hero as helping me. And the true leader is the one who is not have number of followers, but who will have, who can make the number of more leaders by among themselves. And each one of you can go home, your neighbor, your friend, your relative, or yourself. And I want to give this awareness about cadaveric transplant in human organs. Each one of us has the ability to do that from now. So what is organ donation? Either a live or a dead person, recently dead person, his organs can be used in another person, is a cortical transplantation. 10 million and more people are requiring some kind of organ, maybe eye, maybe skin, maybe kidney, maybe liver, maybe heart, lung, intestine, pancreas, whatever. More than that, and it's full counting at the need of India, that is the need of an hour of the requirement of the organs today. The living organs, living donors, you know, some organs can be donated by the living person, and cadaveric donors can have almost all the organs. At our time, when I was in a third MBBS, we did not have a chapter on a brain death. But now, there is a chapter on a brain death and how to declare them, and that is very, very important. And I think that is most important thing that every one of us as a MBBS doctor or anybody you become, then you must understand there is a potential of donation in many of the patients which you come across or see across. There are two types of organ donations, voluntarily, opt-in and opt-out. In India we do is opt-in. In Spain and in some European countries it's opt-out. What is opt-out? Opt-out means I have opted out of donation. When I become an 18-year-old in Spain, I have to declare that I do not wish to donate my organs. Then and then only my organs will not be taken. Otherwise, if I get brain dead or accident or something, when I die, they will not ask the relatives, they will not ask the family, they will not look for the wish or will. They will take the harvest the organs. That is opt-out. In India, it is impossible to come. But even in opt-in, I think we should tell our relatives, because at that time in Australia, they have a driving license. In India also, they are coming with a driving license. And I want my driving license, but nobody knows, in my family also knows, that I am for organ donation. In Australia, they have got organ donation program and it comes on a driving license. But once it is on a driving license, it goes to the computer, to the national list, to all the hospitals, to all the police stations, to all the centers and ministry, that this person is an organ donor. And when I am admitted as a casualty, and if my ID is put in that computer of the any hospital, it flashes that I am an organ donor. Then no relatives will be asked. Here it is not like that. Who is going to look for my driving license? Or who is going to look for my the wish or a will? Or who is going to my card of donation that I have taken my pledge or oath that I will donate my organs? Who, at that hour, it is impossible. Everybody is in shock that something has happened to me or some accident has happened. It happened so suddenly. And it's not the fault of the relatives or the family. It is an emotional state like that. And that is why we must tell. Amazingly, few days back, I did one transplant on an 8-year-old girl. This beautiful young girl, small girl, and she had a viral myocarditis. She was taken to the hospital and they told it's the last day, nothing can be done. Somehow I had done some 5-6 transplant by that time, and they came to us, and then I enrolled her in the program, and I tried some medicines like newcomers of the medicines, but it did not work for, it worked for a while, but to cut the story short, I was waiting for a transplant on her and I put her on high alert. I sent her blood to the Chennai also and to Calcutta, Bangalore also, Hyderabad also, that if you have a donor of that age group, please, please, please let me know. I will get the patient there or get the organ from there to here. To get organ from there to here, unless we get an aircraft like armed forces, as it is impossible because it takes 2 hours in a flight only and the organ goes waste anyway. So I can take the patient directly there to Chennai, but I don't want to see her dying. And so I took her blood and sent it to Chennai and Hyderabad, that when you, anytime you get a donor of her age group, and we are allowed 10% weight here and there. So her weight was 30-35 kilos, and maybe 40 kilos to 25 kilos to 30 kilos, any donor would be suitable for her. And luck would have it, or bad luck of that patient would have it. He's an NRI, living in Australia for many, many years, born in Australia. A 7-year-old boy, and the 7-year-old boy, he looked at his mother's, and there was some program in the school in Sydney that for organ donation. And then when he came home and he asked his mom to show her driving license, and he saw that driving license, she has donated her organs, and he asked his dad, and dad did not have that, and so he was insisting on dad that you must have that. And today we have a program in the school. This was many months back or a year back. And we had a school, and in the school this was done, and I want to pledge my organs. If something happens to me like this. They were on a holiday in India, in Bangalore and Mumbai. He had some deep, the thrombosis of his cavernous sinuses and the serrated sinuses, veins in the brain. And he was declared brain dead. All investigations and everything was done. Being being Indian also, but born and brought up in Australia, the mother knew his wish, and that is why she pledged the organs. That is why she decided to donate the organs. But it is amazing, you know, that 7-year-old boy. So what organs you can donate? Everything you can donate, as much as you want to. And there are live donors and cadaver donors. Live donors, the majority are happening in India. But in India, if we decided to honestly declare the brain dead, honestly decide to declare brain dead, after that how many will donate and is not in our hands. We cannot make it compulsory also. But if we declare brain dead patients and then realize that how many organs are going in a dustbin, it's a national property, it's a national treasure. The organs does not belong to anybody once you are brain dead. Remember, anybody, not to the family, not to anybody. But we have a possessiveness and we have this and that. But if in India, if we really honestly decide to do for a cadaver program, there is no need of live donors. There is no need of live programs. Why a live person has to give one kidney to somebody else? Why to give one half of the liver to somebody else? We can take the cadaver, but majority in India is live donors. There is no waiting period. So whenever I want, I can get it. In cadaver, there is a waiting period, but there is a need of an hour today in India. You know the different types of death, somatic death, brain death, and live donors. I am not going to detail of it. But organ donation issues in India are community problem, hospital problem, and government problem. I am not going to address all of them here. But some community-based problems, as I always explain to you, and there is emotional shape, relatives of the donors are not willing for certain reasons. And then when I'll tell you some stories which I have come across, which honestly, I had one cardiac recipient. The patient had dilated cardiomyopathy. He was 49-year-old, on a waiting list. Every week he used to call me. Sir, mera kab hoga? Sir, mera kab hoga? I said, I need to get your blood group cross match and your weight and height and everything properly. I'll definitely call you. And October end, I did my fourth transplant. And it was 27th or 28th of October, I had forgot. But I called him because his blood group was the same. And he said, 4th November is my insurance maturing and I want to renew it and I would like to wait. I'm happy now. I'm fine now. See, I'm fine now. I said, okay, no problem. So I gave it a chance to somebody else. 10th of November, this patient landed in my hospital at 11 o'clock night with paralysis. He had a clot in his left ventricle, which is dilated cardiomyopathy, is very well known, and it embolized it and paralysis. The stroke was so bad that he had to put on ventilator, and while treating that, he had a massive brain hemorrhage. Now, he becomes a donor. Apart from his brain and heart, he becomes a donor of his kidney and liver, you see, or skin and eye. His son is in third MBBS. His younger brother is an MBBS doctor. His cousin is an orthopedic surgeon in Mumbai. The family refused. They don't believe in organ donation. A man who was waiting for somebody to give his heart to him, now he is not willing. I had another donor who was in Trambakeshwar, Pandit family, Bhadji family, and he had a brain hemorrhage, and he was doing home, and he fell in Kunda, that home. And he had little bit burns, that was not an issue. But then he was brought to Mumbai for his brain dead, and he was declared brain dead. The family was willing to give the brain dead, but being a Pandit and family of Bhadji and that, they said that this is a Rahu Kal and Amavasya is there, so we do not want to declare him dead. So it was Thursday and Amavasya and Rahu Kal was going to finish on Saturday evening 4 o'clock. When they was declared that okay, fine, now nothing is happening, he is not improving, they decided to donate organs. By that time his liver was in dustbin, kidney was in dustbin, heart was in dustbin. So these are the emotions, these are the different variety. I'm not saying we can force them, I'm not saying challenging anything. I'm just trying to set the scenarios which it's different scenario altogether than just to a bypass operation or a valve operation. Amazing world we can see here. And then the community issues are there, are the rituals possible, everything is possible. There are frequently asked questions to me, can 85-year-old donate? Yes, they can donate. Not all, I will not take the heart of the 85-year-old, but yes, certain organs definitely we can take. There's an 92-year-old lady who had donated her liver to a 17-year-old boy. And then can someone with diabetes donate? Yes, they can donate certain organs with the diabetes. Can with the glasses donate? Yes, of course, somebody can with the glasses can donate. Then somebody asked me, can somebody with a cancer can donate? Yes and no, because the cancer of the brain or the brain tumor, yes, they can donate. If it is not a malignant tumor which is metastasizing, you can donate. If it is malignant tumor, metastasizing everywhere, they cannot donate. Someone with HIV, no means no. And the red ribbon is for those who cannot donate. And then somebody can with hepatitis C, again, yes and no. I will not take the heart from the hepatitis C patient. But there are many patients with the renal transplant and liver transplant itself who has got hepatitis C. So they can take the liver and kidney off. So hepatitis C patient can donate to the hepatitis C patient, you see. So that can be arranged and accepted. So someone with the suspicious circumstances, road traffic accident or some trauma or something, yes, they can donate. And now the police and all are there, so helpful to get this emergency and everything done. They do not harass us, they do everything, post-mortem and everything is so smoothly is being done that the relatives and nobody is harassed for that, and they get this green ribbon. So recently asked again a question. So there is the questions which are asked, if donation occurs, the funeral is still possible? Of course funeral is possible. There is two difference between, I must say, that there is a difference in organ donation and body donation. When it comes to the body donation, it goes to the medical college or the fraternity, medical fraternity, where they can do the dissection or teaching on the cadavers that has been done. So that is, then funeral is not possible. The donating organs, yes. If you have donated organs and the body, then funeral is not possible. But if donation organs, of course the funeral is possible. Are any religious reasons against it? Absolutely not. And there is my next motion that movement I'm going to do is that get the religious heads on the same platform like this and discuss among themselves who is against and who is not. So is there a signed donor card? The donors bother to women say, yes. If I'm carrying a donor card, Will the doctors be keeping me alive, or they are not bothered? No, he's going to. In fact, if you are a donor and you understand that if you are declared as early as possible that he is a donor, then we try to keep them alive as much as possible. Otherwise, I cannot take the heart, I cannot take the liver, I cannot take the kidney. Understand that? Once the patient is declared brain dead, the doctors and the intensivists and the nurses, their enthusiasm in keeping the patient alive goes. Absolutely goes. They don't look at them. They do not do any tests, they do not look at the blood pressure, they do not do anything. Because he is going to die. Doctor has declared him dead. What is it? There is a difference in what? Understand the difference in brain dead and coma and live person. I was taking the lecture for the last 7 months, almost 50-70 lectures I had taken for the doctors, and amazingly he told me that many of the doctors said that my patient who is, I know his brain is not going to work, neurologist has come and declared that nothing can be done, neurosurgeon said nothing can be done, but his heart is functioning, ECG is there, blood pressure is there, he is passing, how can I declare him dead? Otherwise we are keeping artificially alive, understand that. When we say somebody dead, if his heart stops functioning or brain stops functioning? And the professor, when I was telling the students in the class of third MBBS, and he said that if I say that the brain stops functioning, you should be declared dead, then half of the class is dead. But jokes apart, but our, if we say the heart stops functioning, then our hearts, when our heart starts functioning, when we are 4 weeks old in mother's womb, 4 weeks old, but we didn't keep ourselves alive. We are born when I take my first breath, and I am dead when I take my last breath. And if I cannot take breath because some center in the brain has been damaged, where brain stem and other thing, that I cannot breathe at all, I am declared brain dead. Patient, I can be in coma for years, 10 years, 15 years, but I am breathing. I am not brain dead. Understand this concept. What has happened in Europe and other countries is that they have realized it, that however long we treat them, however care we take, whatever medication and whatever we do in these patients, they do not survive for more than 4 to 5 days. They die. And that is why the concept of brain death and organ donation came from USA and Europe in those patients where we cannot do anything about them. Try to understand that. And it is very, very important to understand, realize, and when the social coordinator, other workers, to make the people knowledgeable and aware that they can do something to help the society or keep their near dear alive in such situations. And so the answer to this question is, we must take utmost care to maintain the blood pressure, to maintain the acidosis. There are so many things to keep them alive. Otherwise, the heart will go in a dustbin, liver will go in a dustbin. Is it true that the wealthier influential get a preference? Absolutely not. It goes by the list by the zonal transplant committee, and there is no way we can play around with. We cannot jump the list just because somebody is a somebody pays money or somebody does not pay the money. What if I am really dead when the donor? There is a panel of experts who decides that I am dead or not, brain dead or not, and it is the apnea test. So apnea test is a test when my all electrolyte and everything is normal. Then all my paralysis and the sedation has been totally stopped for more than 48 hours. My respirator is disconnected for 10 minutes. And if I don't take any breath in 10 minutes, I am declared dead. And this test by the experts is repeated after 6 hours. After 6 hours, minimum 6 hours of gap. And that is called apnea test. That is first apnea test and second apnea test. So there is no way. And it is no objective. It's not because I feel he's brain dead, you don't feel he's brain dead, oh, he's little bit of moving when I touch him. No. There are specific criteria by which you have to just tick, and do an apnea test, which will tell us whether he is brain dead or not. So this is a set of criteria, how we identify them, then compatibility of the blood group, then sickest patient in the hospital get the preference, then stable at home get the preference, and according to the waiting list, it goes on. So the live donations, I am not going to hospital issues, as I explained to you all these hospital issues. And what is important is in Tamil Nadu, declaration of brain death has been mandatory in medical colleges. Mandatory, compulsory. And those students who have undergone that, this is Act from 2008, and those who have been passed out their medical college, who are doing the private practice, they are now calling the centers who do transplant, or zonal transplant committee, that look, I have a patient who is a brain dead and somebody can convince, or I am also going to help and convince them. The people in a transplant team of liver, kidney, heart cannot talk to the relatives of these organ donors until both apnea tests are done and they are given in writing about the brain organ donation consent. But other doctors and other staff and other people can talk to convince them, to understand them, to give them knowledge. Sometimes it is important that we keep the relative of this patient in the, when we declare them dead, we keep the relatives with them. So these are the other things which are organ donation and which I am not going into the details of it today. Again, I explained to you life insurance policies and driving license cards and all which will help, the government is doing. Those patients, the blood banks, the blood is the first organ donation which has been said, the blood is an organ. And we donate it for many years. And where the blood donors also can be convinced of other organ donations as it starts coming and on. And there is a need of the law. This is one which slide again I want to show or emphasize on. This is the last. I don't want to go in each one of them. But current organ donation rate in India is 0.05 per million population per year. Year. In Europe or in USA, it is 13 to 14 per million per year. In Tamil Nadu and in Kerala, this year it is 3 to 4 per million. Means, if, forget about everybody, if in Mumbai, in India, in Mumbai, 1 per million decides to donate, there will be 1,100 heart and liver transplants, 2,200 kidney and eye transplants. In 1 year, today we are doing some 4 or 5 per year heart transplants. But that is because it's 0.05 per million. So this rate has to be increased and is going up and should be going down. So in Tamil Nadu, there are centers which have been recognized to retrieve the organs. Again, I am not going into the details of it. I just want to tell you about the Nicholas Green effect. The Nicholas Green effect is Nicholas was a 7-year-old boy from USA who went on a holiday in Italy. While playing on a seashore, he got a bullet injury. The parents took him to the hospital. Hospital doctors declared him brain dead. Being an American, they know what brain dead is. And they decided to donate each and every organ of Nicholas. The Italy and European media, newspapers, TV channels, news agencies, they took it to the so much so to their heart that today in Italy or Spain, there is no live donor program. It is all out. Everybody is getting cadaver donations. Similarly, such wave or such thing should happen or will happen in India. And you, each one of you can be a part of it. That's it. The next is my, we have done it as my friend urologist. Next. There is one documented like thing which you have made. He is a urologist. He is from Sion Hospital. And we have made this kind of.
नसीब हूं मैं जो ये जीवन मिला, यश मिला, मान मिला, सुख मिला, पर मन कहता है मन नहीं भरा, अवसान से पहले वो कुछ और करना चाहता है, कुछ और सुनना चाहता है, कुछ और पाना चाहता है, कुछ और और चाहना चाहता है। ख्वाहिशें खत्म नहीं होती, मुरादी पूरी नहीं होती, फिर भी ये मन है कि और जीना चाहता है, और रमना चाहता है, और गाना चाहता है। क्या होगा जब जान न रहेगी तन में, अतृप्त रह जाएंगी कुछ इच्छाएं मन में। जीवन के गणित के इस सवाल का जवाब बड़ा कठिन है। ऐसे लोग भी होते हैं जो जिंदगी का हर लम्हा औरों के लिए जीते हैं, दूसरों के लिए छोड़ जाते हैं अमृत और खुद जहर पी लेते हैं। बलिदान हो जाते हैं कभी देश के लिए, तो कभी हो जाते हैं कुर्बान लोगों के लिए। जान से ज्यादा किसी को आप क्या दे सकते हैं? दूसरों ही से सीखा है जो इस दुनिया से तुम्हें मिला है, वो इस दुनिया को लोगों को वापस कर जाओ। जितना कर सको कर जाओ, बस वापस कर जाओ, यही उसूल है। अब सोचता हूं जब मैं जाऊंगा तो क्या वापस कर पाऊंगा। सच कहूं तो मैं कुछ कह नहीं सकता, कुछ सोच नहीं सकता, पर एक निश्चय अवश्य कर सकता हूं, एक निर्णय जरूर ले सकता हूं तब के लिए, जब वो समय आएगा जब ये मन तन छोड़ कहीं दूर चला जाएगा। संसार को भोग चुके इस तन की अब बारी है। विश्राम अब चिता पर हो या कब्र में, ये तय करने की बारी है। दोनों ही सूरतों में हासिल कुछ भी नहीं होना है, दुख और दुख ही मिलना है, खोना और बस खोना है। एक राह ऐसी है जो रोशनी का सबब बन सकती है, मौत के दर्द को सुकून के एहसास में बदल सकती है। क्या हुआ जो मेरे जिस्म में सांस ना रही, मैं अब भी जी रहा हूं किसी और जिस्म को जिंदा रख के। कौन जाने देह का कौन सा अंग किसी पुश्ती जिंदगी को रोशन कर जाए, किसी मुरझाए चेहरे पर मुस्कान भर जाए, इल्म और इलाज की नई राह खोल जाए। न रहने के बाद भी जीवित रहने का अनुभव कराने वाला देहदान जीवन को एक और जीवन देने का नाम है, महान है, महादान है, पुण्य का काम है। जीने के लिए जीना ही जिंदगी है, ना कि मरने के लिए। मरकर भी तो जिया जा सकता है जमीन पर लोगों के लिए। दे भी तो वो रहा हूं जिसकी मुझे अब जरूरत नहीं, किसी के भी काम ना आ सकूं इतना तो गया गुजरा नहीं। ना चिता की राख बनूंगा, ना कब्र में कैद रहूंगा, मेरी फितरत रही है आजादी, आजाद ही रहूंगा।
थैंक यू, थैंक यू वेरी मच।
बेहतरीन मुजाहरा कर सकूं, हसरत रही है ये मेरी, जीते जी ना सही, मर कर ही पूरी हो जाए ये ख्वाहिश रहेगी मेरी। इसी के लिए जान दे सकूं ये किस्मत नहीं।
That was so inspiring, sir. I'm sure the audience enjoyed listening to you. May I now request our Dean, Dr. Suleiman Merchant, sir, to present, sir, with a token of our appreciation.
So, thank you, Anvay. That was a fantastic lecture. I think all of you all, some of you all get inspired. Let's spread the message throughout the nation. I think this is a wonderful thing. Thank you for being here, sir. Like it said, किसी की मुस्कुराहटों पे हो निसार, किसी का दर्द मिल सके तो ले उधार, किसी के वास्ते हो तेरे दिल में प्यार, हम सब उसी का नाम है, we can all do that. Thank you, Anvay. Good.